सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्ति। यस् जन्माद्यस्य यतोऽन्वयादितरतः चार्थेष्वभिज्ञस्वराट् तेने ब्रह्महृदाय आदिकवये मुह्यन्ति यत्सूरयः। यत्र त्रिसर्गो मृषा धाम्ना स्वेन सदा निरस्तकुहकं सत्यं परं धीमहि सच्चिदानन्दरूपाय विश्वोत्पत्यादिहेतवे तापत्रयविनाशाय श्रीकृष्णाय वयं नुमः। यं प्रव्रजन्तमनुपेतमपेतकृत्यं द्वैपायनो विरहकातर आजुहाव पुत्रेति तन्मयतयातरवोभिनेदुः। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरये। यस् सो यस्टर्डे वी हैड सीन इन द मंगल श्लोक द फर्स्ट वर्स इटसेल्फ क्लियरली इंडिकेट्स वॉट इज द एसेंस ऑफ भागवतम। It talks about Advaita Jnanam. So then the story proceeds. So in the Naimisha forest, all great rishis had assembled performing certain yagas for attaining the Supreme Lord. So once they had some time, so all of them assembled at the feet of Suta Brahmarishi and then put forward this question. What is the question? O Rishi, O Lord, you are well acquainted with all the scriptures, Dharma Shastras, Puranas, Itihasas, etc. So whatever you have studied, whatever you have taught, please give us the essence of the knowledge. In the sense, what is the easiest and the best sadhana one must perform in this Kali Yuga, which will give one person the ultimate good, Shreyas? What is it to be done? So this was the question put forward. So how did Suta Rishi start? First of all, he prostrated to his guru. Then only he started giving the answer. How did he prostrate to his guru? By the way, who is his guru? Shuka Brahma Rishi is his guru. Whose guru? Suta Rishi's guru. So therefore, before answering this question, first of all, Suta Brahma Rishi remembers his guru. Which is that verse? That verse which is present there. यं प्रव्रजन्तमनुपेतमपेतकृत्यं द्वैपायनो विरहकातर आजुहाव पुत्रेति तन्मयतयातरवोभिनेदुः तं सर्वभूतहृदयं मुनिम् आनतोऽस्मि। ऐ प्रोस्ट्रेट् अन्टु मै टीचर् दट् मुनि हुइजि। The description is given in the verse. यम प्रव्रजन्तम् अनुपेतम् अपेतकृत्यम्. So his glory is mentioned in this verse, the glory of Shuka Brahma Rishi. It is said, according to this verse, Shuka Brahma Rishi, when he was born, who is his father? Vedavyasa Rishi. So it is said that even at a very young age, even when his thread ceremony was not performed, Anupetam, he took sannyas. He gave up all activities of the world and then just left everything and started walking into the forest. No attachment to anyone. So the glory of the Guru is being pointed out here. At a very young age itself, he left everything and took directly to sannyas, even before his Upanayana ceremony was performed. And then what happened to Vyasa Rishi? Dvaipayanaha virahakatara ajuhava. Vyasa Rishi started running behind this boy, crying out of that pang of separation, out of that attachment for his son, little son. Putra iti. Oh my dear son, don't go, don't go. So who is behind? Vyasa Rishi. And then what happened? Tanmayataya taravaha abhineduhu. Who responded? So here is Vyasa Rishi running behind this boy saying that, please don't go, please don't leave your father and go. I love you so much. And this boy, he did not respond. The trees in the forest responded, saying that your son has become the self of all beings. Now your son is no more your son, he is the self of all beings. Tam sarva bhuta hridayam. That self of all beings who is residing in the heart of all, to that Guru my prostration. So now see, Suta Rishi, according to him, who is Shuka Brahma Rishi? Not a boy, or not his guru, not in that embodiment. No, he is the self of all beings. So he is looking his guru as his own self. As you evolve in knowledge, as you evolve in devotion, you will no longer see your guru as a mere physical embodiment. You start seeing guru, you start seeing God as your own self, not different from you. This is the culmination. So first of all, Suta Brahma Rishi remembers his teacher. Now this is our tradition. Whenever we try to answer a question of someone, whenever we give this knowledge to someone, what is the first thing to be done? Let us keep in mind, whatever knowledge we are giving, it is not ours. It has come from Guru Parampara. Now see, Bhagavatam is, it has not mentioned everything, anything. It has just indicated. Before answering this question, Suta Brahma Rishi remembers his teacher. So we must be grateful to this Guru Parampara, the tradition of Gurus. Each Parampara transferring this knowledge to the next. And thus, we have all the scriptures in hand at present. Whether it is Vedas, or the Upanishads, or the Bhagavad Gita, or the Bhagavatam, all the scriptures are there with us. Because of whom? Because of this Guru Parampara. So our prostrations to that Guru Parampara, our sincere gratitude to them. So he remembers his teacher. In the next verse also, he glorifies his teacher. He says, to that Guru, who is the son of Vedavyasa Rishi, who has brought out this Bhagavatam for the welfare of all, which contains the great secrets of the Puranas, which is like the lamp of knowledge to dispel the darkness of ignorance, because of which all beings are suffering. So this Bhagavatam is considered as a lamp of knowledge, dispelling the darkness of samsara. And this Bhagavatam is Shruti Saramekam, the essence of all scriptures. So to that Shuka Brahma Rishi who has given this knowledge to us, to that Rishi our prostrations. With these two verses, then one more verse.
Narayanam namaskritya naram chaiva narottamam devim sarasvatim vyasam tato jayamudiraye.
It is said, this Bhagavatam should be studied, remembering whom? Naram, Narayanam. The two great rishis who are eternally meditating in the Himalayas for the welfare of all. Prostrating unto Naranarayana rishis. And then Devim Saraswatim. Prostrating unto Saraswati Devi. Vyasam. Prostrating unto Vyasa Rishi. Who gave Bhagavatam to Shuka Brahma Rishi. So prostrating unto these divinities, we must start the study of Bhagavatam. So after having prostrated, now Suta Brahma Rishi starts answering this question. So how does Suta Brahma Rishi answer? Suta Rishi says, excellent is the question you have asked. O Shaunaka Rishi, you have asked an excellent question. Why is it an excellent question? It is an excellent question because this question gives an opportunity for me to answer, and this answer is something which is going to be in the welfare of all beings. Okay, now your question is, which is the easiest sadhana, the best sadhana to be performed, isn't it? In one verse I will give you, what is it?
Savai pumsam paro dharmah yato bhakti radhokshaje ahaitukya pratihata yayatma samprasidati.
Yes, one verse. Savai pumsam paro dharmah. This is the greatest duty of a human being. Parama dharma it is. This is the greatest duty. What is that?
Ahaituki apratihata adhokshaje bhakti.
He must cultivate, try to cultivate devotion for God. This is the greatest duty of a human being. What kind of devotion?
Ahaituki apratihata.
Ahaituki means without any hetu. Hetu means condition. Unconditional. Let him try to develop unconditional love for God. Apratihata means uninterrupted. Let him try to cultivate uninterrupted, continuous devotion for God. Uninterrupted, unconditional devotion for God. This should be the ultimate goal of any human being. Why should I do so? It is because yayatma samprasidati. This alone is going to give a person complete fulfillment. What is the purpose of life? Complete fulfillment is the purpose of life. Happiness, joy, contentment is the purpose of life. This you get it directly from bhakti, devotion. Now later on, so the Brahma Rishi is going to say why it is easy, why is it the best, etc. Later on. Now, one may ask, but we have heard that knowledge is the greatest. Now you are saying bhakti is the greatest. Now listen.
Vasudeve bhagavati bhakti yoga prayojitah janayatyashuvairagyam jnanam cha yadahaitukam.
The moment you start developing devotion for God, Vasudeve Bhagavati Bhakti Yoga Prayojitaha, as you start developing devotion for God, automatically the other two also comes along with it. What are the other two?
Jainayati Ashu Vairagyam Jnanam.
These two starts coming automatically. In Bhagavata Mahatmyam, Who are this jnana and vairagya? Sons of bhakti. Bhakti Mata has got two sons. Who are they? Jnana and Vairagya. And Bhakti Mata has got one Dasi also. Who is she? Mukti. Mukti comes free. Dasi means what? She has no other choice. Wherever Bhakti is there, Mukti has to be there. Means you don't have to strive for liberation. Liberation is given to you free. Buy one, get one free. But one thing you have to buy. What is it that you have to buy? Bhakti. The moment bhakti enters into your heart, you will find vairagyam coming automatically, jnanam coming automatically. Liberation happens even without your knowledge. That is the glory of bhakti. And what kind of vairagyam jnanam? Yada haitukam. That kind of knowledge which is free from all kinds of doubts. Error free, doubt free, without any controversies, without any confusion, pure knowledge. The example given is just like fruit upon one's own palm. So clear it becomes. How clearly you are able to see a fruit on your palm, so clearly you are able to gain this knowledge about God, about oneself. This is the ultimate purpose. Now Bhagavan is saying, Suta Brahmarishi says, how we are getting confused in this world. What are the Chaturvidha Purusharthas? Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha. Now, people are all confused regarding the purpose of life. Now, there are four things in all of us which has been given free, which everyone will possess. Number one, life. Yes or no? We are living beings, so life is given to us. Number two, ability to perform action, karma. Number three, wealth, dhana or artha. And number four, pleasures of the world, everyone, or kama. These four things are available for all of us. Life, action, wealth, and pleasures. Now our confusion is, if you ask someone, what is the purpose of life? He will say, purpose of life is to earn wealth. He may not say it, but this is what he does. The entire time is spent only in earning wealth. Why does he want wealth? Because wealth can give pleasures. It can give two things, security and happiness, which is nothing but karma. With wealth, I can get sense objects, and indulging in sense objects, I can gain happiness. So, how are these four things employed? Life is employed in performing actions so that these actions can give him wealth, and this wealth can ultimately give him happiness through indulgence of pleasures. Got it? This is what an ignorant person does. And if you look into this world, you will find 99.999999% of the people engaged in this only. Ask him, what is the purpose of life? And this is what he will do. Now here, Suta Rishi makes it very clear. These four things are given, make it very clear in the beginning itself. Why is life? What is the purpose of life? Bhagavan says, Jeevasya Tattva Jitnyasa. What is the purpose of life? Tattva Jitnyasa is the purpose of life. Tattva Jitnyasa means what? Desiring to know the ultimate truth. Or desiring to know God. Or desiring to know oneself. They are all tattvam. Tattva means truth. Jeevasya Tattva Jitnyasa. This is the purpose of life. What is the second one? Action. What is the purpose of action? Purpose of action is not gaining wealth, purpose of action is chittasya shuddhi, purity of mind. Because it is this purity of mind which will help you know the truth. And therefore, whatever actions you perform, it must culminate in devotion for God, which becomes karma yoga. Try to relate. What is karma yoga? Performance of all action as a worship of the Lord and receiving the results as prasad from the Lord. So in essence, what must happen after karma yoga? Devotion must increase. So what is the purpose of action? Purpose of action is purity of mind, which ultimately leads you to the goal. Karma. The third one, artha. What is the purpose of wealth then? The purpose of wealth is to attain dharma. See, artha, dharma, kama, moksha, they are all related. What is the purpose of artha? Gaining dharma. What do you mean by dharma? Dharma means devi sampat. In this world, there are three kinds of sampat, wealth. One is laukika sampat, worldly wealth, in terms of rupees and dollars. The third one is devi sampat, divine wealth. I mean, the second one is divine wealth. Third one is asuri sampat. See, devi sampat and asuri sampat, one chapter itself is devoted in Bhagavad Gita. Devasura sampat vibhaga yoga. Which is that chapter? 16th chapter. So three types of wealth: laukika sampat, daivi sampat, asuri sampat. Now, here Bhagavan is saying, whatever wealth you have in this world, this laukika sampat can be converted into daivi sampat. Use it. Use it for this conversion. Just like you convert rupee to dollar, etc. You can convert laukika sampat into daivi sampat. Make use of this wealth. Because this laukika sampat, you cannot take it, number one. Moreover, this sampat cannot give you peace, happiness, etc. Worldly needs can be fulfilled, that's all. Otherwise, this sampat is a waste. So therefore, what one must strive for, whatever worldly wealth you have, try to do lot of punya karmas, as much as possible. There are so many people suffering because of lack of wealth. There are poor people who don't have food to eat, clothes to wear. There are so much of need for hospitals, schools, etc. Use your wealth in all such places. There are so many ashramas also running. So therefore, donate your wealth and then convert this laukika sampat into punya. Now this punya which you gather, remember, this punya will come along with you after death also. Whereas the laukika sampat, you will have to leave it here. Whereas the punya which you gain through it, it comes along with you. It remains in you as samskaras. And remember, it is this samskara which will determine your next birth. In next birth, which parents you are going to be born? Which species you are going to be born, first of all? Whether human beings or something else. Which species, which parents, which environment, which body, whether the mind, body, etc. will be remain intact or not, which kind of handicap, all those things are decided by what? Not your laukika sampat, it is determined by your devi or asuri sampat. So who is the wise person? Wise person is the one who converts this laukika sampat into punya. Does lot of punya karmas. So then the purpose of artha is what? Dharma. So which sampat is the greatest? Definitely devi sampat is the greatest. So if you have rich amount of devi sampat, you will be born in a very cultured family, educated family, in such a way that at a very young age itself, you are exposed to this kind of knowledge, spiritual knowledge. At a very young age itself, you will be filled with devotion, with knowledge, with dispassion, etc. so that your path towards moksha will be smooth, will be effortless. This jnana, vairagya, bhakti, they are the real possessions, they are the real wells. So therefore the wise one is, a wise person is the one who converts even his worldly wealth into spiritual wealth. So the third one is, artha should be employed for gaining dharma. And what is the fourth one? Kama or bhoga. What about the pleasures of life? Ignorant people, for them pleasures itself is happiness. So therefore maximum indulgence is maximum happiness for them, for the ignorant ones. But for the wise ones, here Bhagavan says, kamasya na indriya priti labha, na indriya pritihi. Kamasya na indriya pritihi. Fulfilling the desires of the senses and thus gaining pleasure out of it is not the purpose of kama. Then what is the purpose? Labha jiveta yavata. The purpose of indulgence is only one, to keep your body, mind, etc. fit. Because indulgence cannot be avoided. Sense objects are there. You cannot but indulge. That is how we have been created. For example, you have to eat food. It is a kind of bhoga only. But the person who eats food for pleasure is the ignorant one. The person who eats food for health, good health, he is a wise person. So whatever bhoga we are doing in this world, it should be geared towards only one goal. What is the goal? Moksha. Yuktahara viharasya yukta cheshtasya karmasu yukta swapnava bodhasya yogaha bhavati dukkaha. No one is saying that you should not indulge. No. Indulgence is permitted, provided that indulgence make your body fit. Because for doing sadhana, you must have a fit body. Normally we think that all spiritual people, they ignore their health. No. Nowhere it is said like that. You have to keep your body fit. For that you have to do yoga, pranayama, etc. Body has to be free from all kinds of disease. In Kena Upanishad, what is the first invocation mantra? Apyayantu mamangani vak pranas chakshu shrotra matho balam indriyani cha sarvani. Isn't it? O Lord, give me good health. May my senses be strong, active, healthy, brilliant, so that I may walk this path. So that body and mind will not trouble me. So that my attention will not again and again go to this body. If suppose you have an unhealthy body, where will be your attention be? Unto the body only. What meditation can you do then? Your knee is paining, your head is paining, your back is paining, your neck is paining. Now what meditation will you do? You will do meditation on pain. Pain meditation you will do instead of home meditation, isn't it? It's a distraction. So therefore, you must have all your instruments well intact, healthy, in order that your flight in meditation be smooth. So therefore, what is the purpose of kama? Purpose of kama or bhoga is one, to keep yourself healthy. Right. So these are the ways in which the wise people employ the God-given gift. What are the God-given gifts? Life, ability to perform action, then wealth, and then the pleasures available. Right? Now it is said, jivasya tattva jitnyasa. What is this tattvam? Vadanti tat tattva vidaha tattvam yajnanam advayam brahmeti paramatmeti bhagavan iti shabdyate. This tattvam is known by different names. Some may call it Brahman, some may call it Paramatma, some may call it Bhagavan, etc., etc., etc. It is one and the same. And what is that? This tattvam is jnanam advayam. It is non-dual knowledge. Non-dual knowledge means what? When the knowledge takes place, it should take place as, this is me. meaning what? The known should merge into the knower. The knower and the known should become one. This is called Advayam Jnanam. So what is to be known? Bhagavan is to be known. How he should be known? He should be known as one's own self. This is Tattvam. The goal of life is Tattva Jitnyasa.
Tachraddhana munayah jnana vairagya yuktaya pashyantyatmani chatmanam bhaktya shruta grihitaya.
Who gains this knowledge? Shraddhanaah, those who have faith in the teacher, in the scriptures. Such munayah, contemplative ones, jnana vairaga yuktaya, endowed with knowledge and dispassion, bhaktya, endowed with devotion. Where do they experience this truth? Pashyanti atmani atmanam. They experience this truth in one's own self, as oneself. This is the experience. Not someone different from himself.
Pashyanti atmani atmanam.
But if you want to experience, what are the things to be needed? Jnana, vairagya, bhakti. Now what is that one thing with which everything else will come? Bhakti. This is the point. The glory of devotion is slowly brought out. But Rishi, from where should we start? From where should we start? A beautiful verse.
Shushrusho sraddhanasya vasudeva katharuchihi syan mahat sevaya vipra punyartirtha nishevanat.
Yes. Start from here. Where? Punya tirtha nishevanat. What is that? Punya tirtha sevanam. Meaning, go to the sacred places. Places of pilgrimage. Tirtha yatra. This is the first step. Now here, tirtha yatra is not like the way we do. How do we do? At least 6 places in a day. And you book a bus and then rush. Not that way. So in those days, this is one of the very important and very potent sadhana given for spiritual seekers. Visiting holy places. So when you visit a holy place, what are the things you must keep in mind? Number one, find out why that place is holy. There will be some mahatmyam. Now don't worry whether that mahatma is fake or real, etc. Don't worry about it. Whatever is said in the scriptures, just have faith. Because what is important is, when you go to that place, that bhavana should rise. Oh my God, this is the place where such and such mahatma has meditated. Like for example, when you go to Dakshineshwar, that room where Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, that cot, etc., where Ramakrishna Paramahamsa is to lie down. So when you see that cot, what do you see? You don't see a cot there. Cots are plentifully available even in your own native place. When you go there, when you see that cot, what do you see? You see Ramakrishna there, isn't it? And all those love and respect and reverence for Ramakrishna and all those stories which are there in the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. I hope you have read that book. If you have not read, please read it. How Ramakrishna Paramahamsa used to go to Samadhi in that place, and how those devotees used to dance around him. And all those instances, the moment you see that cot and the room, your heart is filled with that kinds of emotion, isn't it? Now what is happening? Your mind is getting purified. So whenever you read the mahatmyam of a place, the glory of a place, don't worry whether it is real or fake. Whatever is given in the scriptures, believe that it is true. Then what is the advantage? Advantage is your heart will be purified. Because the heart gets an opportunity to bring out all those noble emotions. But suppose you go as a historian. Let me find out. Let me take some samples and find out whether this really existed or not. Then you are missing the point. The purpose will not be served. Neither you can prove or disprove that such an incident had taken place there. You can't prove or disprove. So the best thing is, if you are a spiritual seeker, have total faith and go to that holy place. So before going to the holy place, what you must do? What is the homework? The homework is collect all information. What all great things have happened in that place? Who are the Mahatmas who have lived? And who are the Mahatmas who are living? Then when you go there, so this is Punyar Tirtha Sevanam. And when you go there, don't go there just to be there and come back. Spend some time there. Spend some days there. In olden days, people used to go walking and they used to stay there for months together. So normally such Tirtha Kshetras will be near some river, in a forest, etc. Very, very conducive for all kinds of spiritual sadhanas. So when they go there, what do they do? What you have to do is, normally in such Tirtha Kshetras, there will be lot of Mahatmas, great saints and sages. In olden days, it used to be the case. So therefore, we have to see in that light. So in olden days, all saints and sages, they used to stay where? In such Tirtha Kshetras, not in metropolitan cities, etc. So in such places they used to stay. So whenever you want to have satsang with Mahatmas, where you have to go? You have to go to such holy places. So after going there, what you are supposed to do? Next one, Mahat Sevaya. Second one, what you are supposed to do? Go and meet such saints and serve them, be with them. Mahat Seva. So what happens when you do Mahat Seva? You get an opportunity to be with them. And when you are being with them, what happens to you? Naturally, you start seeing how these people live. And how do they live? They live a life of contentment, absolute joy, absolute peace, lot of devotion, lot of dispassion, lot of love, lot of humility. All these virtues you start seeing in that person, isn't it? And the wonder is, they don't have anything with them. Very, very poor. With respect to the material riches, they are very poor. But at the same time, you find embodiments of divinities in them. Because you have seen worldly people also. You have seen worldly people, how selfish they are, how narrow-minded they are. And the moment you come here, you see totally a different species. Totally different. Selfless, loving, compassionate, merciful. So slowly when you start associating with them, slowly, slowly they become your role models. This is how I want my life to be. Now how did those Mahatmas attain that state? They attained that state because of their regular meditation, regular sadhana. As you do keep doing regular sadhana, your personality becomes very, very sweet. That is how they have become Mahatmas. So when you are associated with such sweet personalities, what happens to you? You start adoring them. You start revering them, respecting them. Then what happens? Next term, Shushroshaha. You earn to listen to them. You become very much desirous to listen to them. Those people whom you love, whom you respect very much, revere very much, you always want to listen to them. Yes or no? Yes. You wait for them to speak. This is the biggest mistake which parents do. They give lot of advice to their children, but the children are in no mood to listen. Why? Because they don't respect their parents. Simple. Why don't they respect their parents? Because that is how they live. Life of indulgence, life of compromise, loose living, no values, nothing. How can the children have respect and reverence for their parents? And if they don't have respect, why should the children listen to their parents? Isn't it? These are all psychology. What kind of impression the parents have left in the minds of the children, accordingly children will respond. If the parents are not living a life of values, remember, children will not value parents. How much ever valuables parents may give them. Values are different from valuables. Many parents think, let me give whatever my child wants. That is not the way. Pampering alone will not earn that respect and reverence from children. No. When you live a life of values, people who are associated with you, they will be inspired by you. So now what happens here? Now you are doing Mahat Seva, you are in association with the saints and sages, slowly they become your role model. And then you want to listen to them. And whatever they say, whatever advice they give, what will be your attitude? Shraddha Dhanaha. You will have total faith in them. Yes, if this Mahatma has said it, it must be true. I don't know, but it must be true. In my experience, it has not come, but it must be true. If they say God exists, definitely God exists. If they say God can be experienced, definitely God can be experienced. You see? Though you don't know, but you develop a kind of faith. Why do you develop that faith? You develop that faith because you have faith in that person. You love that person, you revere that person. Now, what kind of upadeshas will these Mahatmas give? Definitely, they will direct your attention towards God. This is what a Mahatma will do. They will discourage all kinds of indulgence in pleasures and they will encourage you to turn your attention to God. Isn't it? How will they turn your attention to God? By telling kathas of God. So the next term comes Vasudeva Katha Ruchihi. You start developing taste for the kathas of the Lord. The main purpose of Srimad Bhagavatam is direct the attention of the seeker through stories. Through stories of the Lord. We don't say stories of the Lord, we say leelas of the Lord. Sportive actions of the Lord. What is the difference between story and leela? There is a difference. In every leela, you will find after listening to the leela, your love for God increases one step further. A mere story may not do so. Story can be different types, but leelas are different. And Bhagwan's avatar, they are all called leelas because it is a sport for him. It is not samsara like us. For us, every moment is suffering, misery. But for Bhagwan, every moment is a sport. Even dropping of the body is also a sport for him. Isn't it? Therefore, it is called leela. So now, these Mahatmas, what do? They do Vasudeva Katha. And what is the essence of any Katha? If you can summarize the essence of any Katha, this is what will happen in every Katha. There is a devotee who is in extreme distress. He tries to get rid of all these problems by so many means. Maybe through wealth, with influence, with relation, with this, that, etc. And he is not able to come out. And ultimately, out of helplessness, out of total surrender, he turns to God. Bhagwan, Trahimam, Prahimam. Save me, Trahimam, Pahimam. Protect me. And what happens? Suddenly, blessing, grace descends and the problem is solved. Yes or no? This is the essence of every katha. This person is trying to solve his problem by his own ways. He is not able to solve. And as a last refuge, probably without faith, he turns to God because there is no other way. And there he gets appropriate response, by which he is able to overcome his difficulties. This is the essence of every katha. So when you listen to katha, what happens to you? You are able to relate yourself to that katha because there is one character who is suffering. You are able to relate. This is me. Because there is not a single person who is not suffering in this world. Reasons can be many, but every moment we are experiencing our limitation. We are trying to overcome our limitation. We are trying to get rid of our problems, our suffering. So when you listen to this story, you are able to relate to it. Because there is a character which actually resembles your character. And now he has come out by grace of God. So naturally, what will be your tendency? When you continuously do katha shravanam, you start applying it in your life. And how do you apply it in your life? Whenever you are in distress, your mind will turn to God. When you are with samsaris, your mind will not turn to God. Your mind will turn to samsara only, some means of samsara. But when you are in association with the devotees, your mind slowly develops this habit. Because he has done a lot of katha shravanam, mind develops a habit of turning towards God. And there he finds peace, he finds guidance, he finds solace, he finds comfort. And when he starts seeing results, what happens to his faith? The faith in God starts increasing. Love in God starts increasing. Slowly, the relationship with God becomes stronger and stronger. Are you able to relate one to the other? Relationship becoming stronger means what? From then onwards, whenever you are in trouble, you turn towards God and you start experiencing His guidance. Where is God seated? In your own heart. And what will that God do? Remember, once you have developed this relationship, Bhagwan starts feeling that now this devotee is mine. Then he takes the responsibility. Initiative, who has to take? The devotee has to take. But once you have taken the initiative, once you have said, Bhagwan, I am yours. Now, whose responsibility it is to protect the devotee? It becomes Bhagwan's responsibility. He also starts responding in the same coin. Then the next one comes. What is the next one?
Shrinvatam swakatham krishnah punyashravana kirtanah hridyantastohya bhadrani vidhunoti suhrat satam.
Bhagwan is called Satam Suhrit. Satam Suhrit means what? Friend of all noble hearted people. Satam Suhrit. He is a friend. He is a well wisher of all devotees. So what does he do? Now that the devotee has started invoking his presence, he has developed a relationship. Now Bhagwan starts doing the rest. What is his job?
Hridi antastaha abhadrani vidhunoti.
He starts washing clean all the dirts of the mind. Mind is filled with impurity, filled with dirt. What does Bhagwan do now? Now that the devotee has allowed Bhagwan entry into his heart, till now entry was prohibited. As long as you don't invoke God, for him entry is prohibited, isn't it? That is why in Bhagavad Gita always we find there is one clause. What is the clause? Seek me, then I will do the rest. Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam raja. Surrender unto me. That is the first condition. Who has to do? Bhakta has to do. Rest I will take care. What is that?
Aham tva sarva papebhyo mokshesyami mashuchaha. Name bhaktaha pranashyati. Bhaktaha na pranashyati.
That's the condition. Others, definitely. Meaning what? Once you have become a bhakta, once you have sought the guidance from God, he has to come. So what will you do?
Hridi antastaha abhadrani. Abhadrani means inauspicious things in the heart, all the impurities, he starts cleaning it.
And then what happens?
Nashta prayeshu abhadreshu nityam bhagavata sevaya bhagavatyuttama shloke bhaktir bhavati naishthiki.
Slowly, as that heart becomes pure, that devotion becomes abiding devotion, strong devotion. As the mind becomes more and more pure, you get naishtiki bhakti, abiding bhakti, strong bhakti, firm bhakti, avyabhicharini bhakti in terms of Bhagavad Gita. So now there is a big responsibility which lands upon the shoulder of the devotee. What is the responsibility? Once you have developed this relationship, he has to live a life in such a way that it will please God. This is the big responsibility of a devotee. my relationship with God will remain intact so long as I live a life pleasing God. My action must be such that it pleases God. My thoughts must be such that it pleases God. So now what becomes the only concern for a devotee? The only concern is, Bhagwan, are you pleased with me or not? I am not worried about results of my action. I don't care about karma phala. I care about only one thing. Are you happy with me? Whatever I have done, was it wrong? Was it right? Did it please you? Because for you, now this relationship becomes very, very important. And once you find that you have done something out of your own strong negative vasanas, you have done something, you have compromised somewhere, then you start becoming miserable. Because when you look within, you find that the relationship is strained. Bhagwan says, my guidance is available, my support is available, my strength, everything is available, provided you live a life according to my will, according to my wish. Don't live a life according to your vasanas. Live a life in order to please me. Now this is a big responsibility upon the devotee. Because there are so many vasanas in us which will force us to do something wrong. But at the same time we know that Bhagwan doesn't like it. But then out of compulsion we do. And then when we look within, we find that this relationship is broken. And then the condition of that bhakta is like fish out of water. Miserable. And from that misery, he learns one great lesson. What is that lesson? In order to maintain this relationship, I have to be very, 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 very alert. So slowly what happens? This devotee's life becomes a life of alertness. A life of purity. A life of constant remembrance. And then comes this naishthiki bhakti. It takes time. In the beginning he attracts you by giving whatever you want, by taking you out of problems. But once your attention is turned to him, so in the beginning he allows your faith to develop. And once it has developed to a good extent, then he starts imposing conditions. Are you able to follow it? Naishthiki bhakti. Now you cannot be immoral. Because now you have tasted the higher joys of devotion. You don't want to miss that joy. You don't want to miss that love which you are receiving from God. You are ready to pay any price for it. Sense pleasures no more attract you. Because this has become the prime importance for you. And once that stage has reached, you have reached that state of naishthiki bhakti. And then what happens?
Tada rajastamo bhavah kamalobhadayaschaye cheta etairana viddham sthitam sattve prasidati.
And once that kind of love develops in your heart,
tada rajah tamo bhavah kamalobhadayaschaye.
These are the negativities born out of rajas and tamas, which you are going to see in the 14th chapter. All negativities, kama, krodha, lobha, moha, madamatsirya, they are born from rajas and tamas. So now that mind becomes etaihi anavidham, free from rajas and tamas. And therefore, free from all impurities. Now there is only one bhava or one guna. What is that guna?
Sthitam sattve prasidati.
Mind is filled with sattva guna. Rajas and tamas is totally washed away. Mind abides in sattva guna. And then what happens?
Evam prasanna manasah bhagavat bhakti yogatah bhagavat tattva vijnanam mukta sangasya jayate.
And now what is the condition of your mind? Your mind is pure. And therefore, prasanna manasah. Prasanna manasah means what? Cheerful. Because of this bhagavad bhakti, in that peaceful, cheerful, quiet mind, what happens?
Bhagavat tattu vijnanam jayate.
This knowledge of the truth regarding God is born. So what kind of mind can only receive this knowledge, spiritual knowledge? A mind which is enriched with sattuguna. And that sattuguna comes due to bhakti. Now this link has to be understood. Once the heart is filled with bhakti, it ever remains in sattvic state. Once that mind is in sattvic state, it is capable of receiving the knowledge regarding the highest reality. And then what happens? Bhidyate hridaya grandhihi chidyante sarva samshaya kshiyante chasya karmani drishta evatmanishvare. A similar verse is found in which Upanishad? Kathopanishad. Bhidyate hridaya grandhihi. Hridaya granthi, the knots of the heart, bhidyate, they are cut asunder. Kshiyante, chidyante, sarva samshayaha, all samshayas, doubts, what happens? They are dispelled. Kshiyante, chasya karmani, all your karmas, sanchita karma, agami karma, everything, kshiyante, they become. They are reduced to naught. They become weakened. Drishta evatmanishvare. When you see that Lord in your own self. Therefore what? Ato vaikavayo nityam bhaktim paramaya muda vasudeve bhagavati kurvantyatma prasadani. So therefore all the wise people, what do they do? Nityam, every day, every moment, what do? This Vasudeve Bhagavati Bhaktim Kurvanti. They try to develop devotion for God through all their activities. So from where did we start? Tirtha Yatra. In Tirtha Yatra, what do? Associate with saints and sages. When you associate with saints and sages, what happens? You are inspired to live such a life. Then you have faith in their words. And then when you listen katha from them, you develop faith in that katha. And slowly you develop faith in God. And then you start developing relationship with God. And once you have started developing relationship with God, then God does the rest. Your job is to surrender unto God. Then ultimately what happens? That supreme truth, that supreme knowledge is bestowed unto you once the heart becomes pure. So therefore, what is the sadhana to be done? What is the sadhana to be done? Bhakti. How to develop this bhakti? So start from the elementary stage. What is the elementary stage? Listening to the kathas of the Lord. Now you understand what is the importance of katha? In Srimad Bhagavatam, this katha is there everywhere. So whenever you listen to katha, don't try to find out whether historically it is relevant or not. Did it really happen? Why are you bothered? If Mahatmas are telling the katha, have faith. Shraddha Dhana, it is mentioned or not, have faith. These scriptures are given by Mahatmas. It really doesn't matter whether it has really happened or not. What matters is, by listening to this katha, is my devotion for God increasing or not? This is all what you have to see. This is all what you have to see. Is my love for God increasing with this katha? Are my negativities going away? Is my dispassion increasing? If it is increasing, then the purpose of katha is served. Right? So therefore, now the stage has been set. So now Suta Brahma Rishi is going to tell the katha. So he says, Idam Bhagavatam Nama Puranam Brahma Sammitam Uttama Shloka Charitam Chakara Bhagavan Rishi. Yes. So this Srimad Bhagavatam, which contains lot of such wonderful stories of Bhagavan, Leelas of Bhagavan, this Srimad Bhagavatam was composed by none other than Bhagavan Rishi, none other than Veda Vyasa Rishi. So he composed it and he passed it on. This Bhagavatam, he passed it on to his beloved son, Shuka Brahma Rishi. This Shuka Brahma Rishi then passed it on to Parikshit, King Parikshit, Raja Parikshit. So he had taken a vow of fast unto death. So one day he was seated near the banks of Ganga. In 1 week's time he was supposed to die. So at that time Shuka Brahmarshi gave this knowledge, Bhagavatam, to Parikshit. At that time I was also there along with so many other rishis. So I happened to hear that. So the very same knowledge I am going to give you. Yathadhitam yathamati. As much as I have understood, as much as I have learned, that I am going to give you. That same Bhagavatam I am going to give you. So suddenly Shaunaka Rishi interrupted. O Suta Rishi, I have a question. Now what is the question? Why did Vyasa Rishi write this? Where did he write it? What was his inspiration? You must tell everything. Directly don't enter into Katha. I want to know all these things. And moreover, you said that Vyasa Rishi gave it to Shuka Brahma Rishi. But as far as Shuka Brahma Rishi is concerned, by birth itself he was perfect. What is the need for him to study this 18,000 verses? There has to be some benefit. So these are some of the questions which I have. So then Suta Rishi said, okay, I will answer. I will tell you the story why Vyasa Rishi wrote this. So that story we will see tomorrow.
Sarve bhavantu sukhinah, sarve santu niramayah, sarve bhadrani pasyantu, ma kaschit dukha bhavave, asato ma sadgamaya, tamaso ma jyotirgamaya, mrityor ma amritam gamaya. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harihi Om Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha.